single day. Through the darkness, oh, you lead the way. You're my treasure forever. Yes, we'll be together.
Welcome to Story Lab. This week, we're getting ready for Easter, while we take a look at what happened the week before the first Easter. Uh-oh, these are gonna be hard to dye. Hey, I'm Skylar.
And I'm Sebastian.
We're getting ready for Easter next week, which is, spoiler alert, celebrating that Jesus is alive.
Are we dyeing eggs to celebrate?
I have a different idea.
Eggs Benedict, omelet, over easy. Oh, pre-scrambled.
If a specially designed egg carton can't protect these eggs from cracking,
what can?
That is my idea.
Well then,
let's make it.
What are we making?
The perfect egg protection device, oobleck.
Ooh, what?
Oobleck. We're making our own oobleck.
It better not rain from the sky.
For this experiment, you need potato starch or corn starch and water.
That's it?
That is 100% of the ingredients.
No food coloring?
Okay, sure, always. Step one, measure 2 cups of potato or corn starch into a bowl.
All right. Ooh. Ooh.
Make sure to clean up your mess at the end.
Is it 2, right?
2.
Now the water.
Step 2, add 1 cup of water.
Colored water.
Colored water. Now mix it all up.
This is weird.
Stay with it. It will mix, I promise.
Done. Oh, it's kind of like Play-Doh.
Yeah, but stop kneading it for a second.
What is even happening?
Oobleck is a non-Newtonian fluid.
You definitely just made that up.
A non-Newtonian fluid like oobleck can be both a liquid and a solid. When you apply quick pressure, the substance becomes thick and viscous. But When you move slowly, the starch particles can slide out of the way. Then the substance oozes and pours like a liquid.
But wait, what about the eggs?
I'm so glad you asked. I hypothesize.
A hypothesis is an educated guess about what will happen in an experiment.
I hypothesize that if we pack oobleck around an egg and drop it.
Oh, the oobleck will turn solid and protect the egg.
Great minds.
Hold up, we need a control subject. If this egg cracks and the oobleck egg doesn't,
then oobleck is even more awesome.
Ready?
You don't have to egg me on.
Ready? Go! It worked!
Let's see that again.
Oobleck is amazing. You expect it to be one thing, but it's actually something else.
Speaking of which, it's time for...
The Story Before the Story.
Today we're in Matthew, the very first book in the New Testament. Matthew carefully recorded the story of Jesus to help people understand that Jesus is God's son.
As Jesus traveled across the land, teaching and healing, the religious leaders got upset with him.
Jesus became more and more popular, and the religious leaders were afraid of losing their power. Everything felt upside down.
Then Jesus raised a dead man back to life.
It was the last straw. The religious leaders decided it was time to get rid of Jesus.
They decided that Passover week would be the best time to do it.
Which is where our story starts.
Take it away.
Hey everyone, I'm Erica. So Jesus had been traveling and teaching people how to love God and love others for about 3 years. He was gaining so much influence with the people that the religious leaders got scared. They figured Jesus was sure to come to Jerusalem for the Passover feast.
When's he going to show up?
We shall order the people to report to us where Jesus is staying.
Then we get him.
Jesus might have known all this was happening, but it didn't stop him. As he and his closest friends made their way toward Jerusalem, they paused on the Mount of Olives in a small town called Bethphage. Jesus called two of his disciples over and gave them special instructions.
Go to the village ahead of you. As soon as you get there, you will find a donkey tied up. Her colt will be with her.
Okay, got it. Then what?
Untie them and bring them to me.
That could be awkward.
If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them. The owner will send them right away.
Okay, then.
Jesus' friends did exactly what he asked them to do. They brought back the donkey and her colt. Then they threw their coats across the donkey's back for Jesus to sit on. Now you've got to understand. Over 3 years, Jesus had walked hundreds and hundreds of miles. There is no other record of him riding any other horse or donkey. So, why did he have to ride this last short distance into Jerusalem? So glad you asked! Over 500 years earlier, many of the Jewish people had been conquered and taken to a faraway land. But some of these people were allowed to return to where they were from and rebuild. Life was difficult, and the prophet, Zechariah, encouraged them to turn back to God. Zechariah even spoke of a king who God would send to rescue them.
Say to the city of Zion, "See, your king comes to you. He is gentle and riding on a donkey. He is riding on a donkey's colt."
Wait, what? Kings are supposed to show up looking impressive, maybe riding a war horse, right? But Jesus came to give himself for others, rather than demanding things for himself. By riding into Jerusalem on a humble donkey, Jesus was showing that he truly is the promised king, the rescuer sent from God. Lots of people were making their way to Jerusalem for the Passover, and a huge crowd gathered. They tossed down their coats and cut palm branches to make a path for Jesus. And they shouted out,
"Hosanna!
Hosanna!
Blessed is the Hosanna! One who comes in the name of the
Blessed
Lord!
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the
Hosanna!
Lord!
Hosanna!
Hosanna!"
The whole city was stirred up, and many people came out to see Jesus, including some of the religious leaders.
This is outrageous.
It's like the whole world is following after him.
Downright preposterous.
Which is why we're going to put a stop to it.
A stop to him.
The stage was set. Jesus had entered Jerusalem on a donkey, showing himself to be the rescuer God promised, our savior. The crowds cheered for him as king, but the religious leaders wanted him out. Through it all, Jesus stayed focused on what he had come to do. The end.
Cliffhanger!
Yeah, I mean, it's festival week and people want to make Jesus king and others want to get rid of him.
Can we just tell the rest of the story, please?
We sure will, next week.
Well, in the meantime, what's our part in the story?
Well, ever since people turned away from God and the world was broken, God had a plan to restore us. God chose one family, the Israelites, and promised to bless the whole world through them. Then, God promised to send a rescuer through that family line.
Jesus!
You're right! Jesus is God's very own son. But Jesus didn't come to take over and fight the Romans like people expected.
Yeah. Jesus showed that it's more important to love and serve other people.
And then, spoiler alert, Jesus chose to give up his life for us. All of us have done wrong things. We've sinned, which is a word for anything that breaks our relationship with God.
But God actually never leaves us, right?
Exactly. God is always with us. But we can turn away and try to live on our own, disconnected from God. Through Jesus, we can be restored to relationship with God. When you choose to follow Jesus, you will be able to live forever with God, no matter who you are or what you've done.
I've heard it so many times, and sometimes I forget how absolutely mind-blowing it is.
Jesus came to rescue me, to rescue you.
To save everyone who follows him, no matter who you are or where you came from.
It's true. God loves you that much. See you next time.
So here's the thing. Jesus came to be our savior.
And because of that, someday everything in this world will be made right again.
It's the most amazing news ever. Thanks for joining us in the Story Lab.
See you next time.
Hey, do you think we could walk on Oobleck? Maybe, but please do not take off your shoes.